Oh, hello, Super Ninfriendos. What's going on? It's episode 608 of Nintendo Voice Chat. I'm your host, Seth Macy. With me here today is Per Schneider.
Very slick opening. Good job.
Thanks. I'm a professional. Kat Bailey.
Well done, Seth. Well done indeed.
I appreciate the kind words, even if they're lies. And Taylor Lyles.
You get an A for effort, Seth.
Awesome. Well, we are off to a wonderful start. You know, it's kind of fitting because I am such a professional, obviously, that I can talk about what I'm doing tomorrow, which is I'm hosting a Wii U loving panel. What? I'm hosting a panel about how much we love the Wii U at PAX East. So if you're in Boston, PAX East at 1:30 in the Condor Theater, Ash Paulson of Good Vibes Gaming, Hip Hop Royalty, Mega Ran, and Hard Drive contributor and game developer Kyle Erf will be joining me to talk about the Wii U and why we still love it. It wasn't all that bad. So if you are at PAX East, please stop by the Condor Theater at 1:30 p.m. Now, let's get right into what everybody in the Facebook group wants us to talk about, which is, of course, how much we hate Xenoblade Chronicles. I'm just joking, obviously. No, we're going to talk about Xenoblade Chronicles 3. The release date has been moved up to July 29th, to be specific. We got a new trailer. We get to see the Ouroboros shown off. There was a special edition revealed, which is a My Nintendo Store exclusive, which means it will be probably pretty difficult to get and it'll go fast. But Kat, you are somewhat of a role-playing game aficionado, would you say?
Yeah, a little bit. It's kind of my brand.
Yeah, I think so. Would you mind speaking a little bit on Xenoblade Chronicles 3?
Yeah, Xenoblade Chronicles is interesting because at this point, it's a long-running series. This is the fourth game, technically, in the series. And it's known for its beautiful vistas, its excellent soundtrack, which has music from Mitsuda, who worked on the Chrono Trigger series, among other things. And I don't think he did the full soundtrack, but he has some songs in there that are really, really nice. And it has a lot of fans within Nintendo because it is a Nintendo second party game. This is kind of connecting Xenoblade Chronicles and Xenoblade Chronicles 2 in a way that I think a lot of people have been waiting for quite a while. The thing that's most interesting about Xenoblade Chronicles 3 at the moment is that it got moved up from September into July. Nintendo did not explain why this happened, but there's already speculation that they're getting out of the way of something else that's been unannounced. Of course, Breath of the Wild 2 got pushed into 2023. As we all know. So the question is, why did Nintendo move up Xenoblade Chronicles 3? I don't know the answer to that outside of rampant speculation, which I'm sure we'll be doing in just a moment.
I was going to say, let's speculate then, but after you're done.
But yeah, I was going to say that I'm actually really happy that they're doing this because I think the summer is the perfect time for an RPG like this. Kind of a quieter time. People will probably be done with whatever they're playing at the moment. And it's a great moment to pick up a big RPG. So I will say that I'm a little surprised because I kind of figured Splatoon 3 would be in that slot.
But that's what I was thinking too. I was thinking Splatoon will be the summer game. And then, you know, this is the, you know, September seemed like the right time for it, where it was like sandwiched in between maybe a bigger November release. But I think this is great. I love seeing this come out earlier. And you said big RPG. There's a lot of big stuff in this game, you know, not just the Ouroboros that the characters can turn into. It's not a snake head eating the head on the opposite side, strangely, but it's that you've got seven characters on screen. Seven. The party is now seven. And with that, you got the Xenoblade typical like crazy HUD with all the buffs and all the actions you can take and everything. I mean, it's definitely, it looks daunting. I love some of the, you've got some recalls to Xenoblade 1 with NTS coming back and all of that. I'm actually really excited for it. It looks really good.
Yeah. Kat, you said it ties Xenoblade and Xenoblade Chronicles 2 together. Could you expand upon that a little bit?
Yeah, sure. At the end of Xenoblade Chronicles Definitive Edition, the remaster, there were plot elements that suggested that the two plots, which Xenoblade Chronicles 1 and Xenoblade Chronicles 2 are on the face somewhat different. And I'm not going to go into all the nitty-gritty right here, but there have been strong hints that Xenoblade Chronicles 3 was going to unite those elements, and is looking like that is going to happen. One thing, I'm going to say lots of nice things about Xenoblade Chronicles in this segment.
Please.
For all of you Xenoblade Chronicles likers out there, I love the aesthetic of this game. Not just the characters, but the world. I think that there's not a lot of kind of worlds like it. It is immediately catches the eye. I think that is really cool. Also, the battle system as a turn-based kind of affair is nevertheless fast-paced and very strategic. And it manages to kind of marry a lot of the best elements in some ways of MMORPGs, classic turn-based, that kind of thing. It actually works really, really well. So from a technical standpoint, I've always been very partial to Xenoblade Chronicles 3. And then as always, in terms of the actual worlds and everything, it reflects, again, the triumph of art style over kind of raw technology. The actual characters are fairly, you know, anime-ish, as we're seeing in this B-roll that we're watching right now. But I think people fell in love with Xenoblade Chronicles the first time they stepped out onto Gower Plains and heard that music and were like, wow, okay, like this feels epic, even for a game that's on the Wii. So,
yeah, I oftentimes
is
wish.
Is it beautiful? It's gorgeous.
Yeah,
I know it's beautiful.
Really wish I loved anything as much as the Xenoblade hardcore love Xenoblade. And they're gonna like, Kat, you've just cemented your status as industry legend among our listeners specifically, because they just are so thirsty to hear people talk so, like, positively and at length and with knowledge about Xenoblade, because I almost said I don't like it, but that's not true.
It's a time
just
commitment.
Never grabbed me. Yes,
that's it, right? It's a big time commitment. Like, you know, the battle system that I always find getting into one of these games really daunting, because there's like layers upon layers in the battle system. It gets really complicated to the point where, you know, you have so many different systems that you might get a little lost. You know, obviously it's also a very long quest, and you can appreciate that it opens up and adds these different layers later on, but they've never been easy to get into. I'll say that. And you saw how pretty Xeno 1 looks there. I do like a lot of what I'm seeing in this trailer for the next one. I want more, you know, I want more things to do in the world, right? It is an open world adventure, even if the worlds are sometimes segmented. Like, I want more things to do than we've seen in the past, but yeah, I'm hoping there's not a lot of other big stuff coming out this summer, so I can finally spend the time these games need and get through them in just a month or so.
Taylor, do you have any history with the Xenoblade saga at all?
No, everyone tells me I should get into it, but it feels so intimidating. And then hearing Kat talk about it, I was like, do I have the time for this? And then it's releasing the same day as Digimon Survive, which I've been waiting years for this game. So I was like, I feel so bad for people that have been excited for both those games, because, oh my, I was like, why did it have to come out the same, both games coming out the same day? I was just like,
brutal.
Yeah.
How long was two? Main story is
quite long.
64 hours, everything 254 hours.
Wow.
Wow. Game.
The part two, that was a launch game for Switch, right? That came out in 2017.
It was in the launch window. It came out December that year. Yeah.
All right. Mm-hmm. Sure. Yeah. I have both of them, and I've given them a go. And it's not that I was bored or that I didn't like them. I just, something else came along and distracted me. And then it's that same old sort of RPG story where if you're away, well, I guess from any large game like that, if you're away for long enough, you kind of forget what you were doing or where you were. And I never got back to it. And I know it frustrates the fans of this show so much. I feel like I have to just put my head down and play through it, because, you know, Kat, hearing, like Taylor said, she was intimidated by what you said, but everything you're talking about, I'm like, well, kind of my cup of tea. Like, complicated.
I think it's pretty accessible by JRPG standards, and the production values are pretty high, all things considered. And it's, like I said, it's coming out in what I like to call the Octopath Traveler window, which is just the perfect moment for a JRPG, for people to dabble in a JRPG like this. And frankly, I love that Nintendo is supporting kind of classical JRPGs that nevertheless managed to do some different and interesting things with their combat, with their exploration. I agree with Pear in saying that I really hope that, for example, they have more complex side quests and that kind of thing when it comes to enhance the exploration of this world. Because in the past, it's been kind of a lot of fetch quests, if I'm being totally honest. But there's a lot of interesting and deep layers to this. It's kind of an underrated franchise. That's what I'm going to say about Xenoblade.
My one fear is just the seven character thing. Like, what are they sacrificing to get this game to run?
Frame rate.
Or maybe it'll just go down in resolution, obviously, to cope with it. But, like, that's pretty ambitious because it's not just seven characters standing around. You see the actions are big. The magic is big and lots of effects going on. So curious to see this.
Oh, I'd love to. Yeah. Exactly what they did. They just made it so that the characters combined and there's half as many characters on the screen.
I'm curious to see how it'll look with on the Switch OLED with the vibrant mode on.
I was thinking the same thing.
When Xenoblade Chronicles 2 came out, it somewhat famously had a lot of issues, if I recall correctly, in handheld mode. Of course, the Switch has come a long way and developers have gotten a lot better kind of understanding of how the Switch tech and everything works. So it'll be interesting to see how Monolith is able to handle Xenoblade Chronicles 3 this time around.
Yeah. When is Gamescom? Is that
August.
It's in
August.
Okay. Because I'm trying to muscle my way into going. I'm like, boy, this seems like the perfect game to
get with you to Germany.
The Atlantic Ocean. Yeah. So I guess my question for you all, and then for, I guess, the people listening, should I start with Xenoblade Chronicles or Xenoblade Chronicles 2? Because I have them both, and I have started them before, and I've gotten pretty far, not pretty far, but I've, you know, several hours into them, and I'm wondering if I want to go back and start so that, you know, I have a leg to stand on when it comes to discussing this series. Which one should I take on?
I think, in my opinion, I think they both stand on their own and you can play either one. It's fine. Xenoblade Chronicles 2 has an interesting gacha system that it adds where you have, I guess you want to say, like, these characters that you're attaching to your party members and you're trying to, it's not pay to win or anything, which is really nice, but so it has that element. I think that Xenoblade Chronicles Definitive Edition, which was remastered for the Nintendo Switch, is more of the straightforward and easier to get into version of the series. And I think characters like Shulk and such are iconic because of appearing in Super Smash Brothers. Yeah. So if I were to pick one Xenoblade Chronicles, I would personally pick Xenoblade Chronicles 1, but I think Xenoblade Chronicles 2 is a good shout too.
All right. Well, then I'll have to
go with one.
Give it a try. Go with one.
Yeah.
I guess the question
I'll give it a shot.
Yeah. Will
I think I'll give it a shot.
I think you'd like it.
Okay. I'll give it a shot.
And my next question is this the power of the Monado? That's what I really want.
It is the power of the Monado, Seth.
Okay.
It's right there. Perfect. There it is.
I played, as you could tell, I played it just enough to be able to make that reference.
My favorite thing about Xenoblade is that all of the characters have these really strong and over-the-top British accents, which is an artifact of it being localized in Europe originally.
And it annoys me. I don't know why it annoys me, but it annoys me.
What, the British accents?
Yeah, and I like British people. You know, some of my best friends are British people, but it's like, no, it feels put on. And there's something to the audio mix too, which sounds like it's recorded in a studio. And that's what bugs me mostly. And like just having this little dude with a super strong Scottish accent is just kind of, I don't know. It's weird. Like I always switch him to Japanese.
Yeah, that's my habit when I play RPGs, but just because I read so much faster and it's so dumb, but I feel like I'm doing a disservice to the voice actors when I don't listen to them. So I'm like, well, if I can't understand them, then I'm not. They
think
wouldn't
they'll be okay.
Insulted.
They got paid either way. So
I know it's dumb. It's not, I don't. I can't explain the way that I am.
It's not that, like, look, fantasy movies use British accents all the time, right? To create some sort of like old timey thing. And it sometimes sounds very out of place if somebody has an American accent in something that's supposed to be like, looks like it's from the 1300s, but somehow, because this, I mean, this is sci-fi, right? So it's not like medieval mm-hmm. fantasy, like the British cast, like it just feels like they're picking one accent from every region, and it just feels really, I don't know, it feels artificial. Like, people, let me know if others feel that way. But it always,
yes, if you're from the Isle of Man.
No, whenever I started, like, it instantly takes me out. I'm like, oh man, they're really going hardcore here. But whatever.
I think people, we can blame that on the original Dragon Warrior.
To people who are playing this in Scotland, they're like, what accent?
That is true. All right, Xenoblade Chronicles 3 out July 29th. We don't have any news on when that special edition goes up, but I can promise you that we will tweet it on IGN Deals or elsewhere, and I'll probably buy it because I just buy special editions now, and then I drop them on the floor before we record Nintendo Voice Chat and break them like I did with the Fire Emblem one. Okay. So now we're going to talk about some rumors, a little handheld system that might be coming to the Nintendo Switch Online service, which we've heard about for a million years now. And that is that Game Boy and Game Boy Advance games are apparently they're not confirmed, but there were leaks posted by, I love this person's Twitter handle, Trash Bandicoot. Okay. On Twitter, showing 4 Game Boy Advance games running on Switch. Apparently, these are emulators developed by Nintendo Europe Research and Development. And there was some data mining, which, you know, no good rumor is without some data mining. But it revealed quite a long list of games that were tested with the emulator. And that doesn't mean that they're going to come out or that any of this is actually even true. But Taylor, could you tell us a little bit about data mining and sort of what this could mean for the future of Nintendo Switch Online, if anything?
Yeah, you know, I think with data mining, it definitely should be taken with like a grain of salt. But I've always looked at these, and I just like take a good look at like all the information that's presented, because I did see that list that somebody else had quote tweeted. I don't think it was Trash Bandicoot, but they quote tweeted someone else that was mentioning the leak, and they said there were a couple of games on that list, like Kingdom Hearts Chain of Memories, that were apparently listed, but they weren't tested. So my takeaway was that, oh, okay, this is like, oh, it'll run on this, but that doesn't mean it might come out, if at all. But I don't know. I think when it comes to just like bringing those games on Switch Online, I feel like it's inevitable. It's more like that if and when to me. And personally, I think they really should just do it. I think the bigger question that I have is, what do the fans think if they think it's going to be part of Switch Online Plus Expansion Pack, or if they're going to put it with the standard Switch Online? Because I think you could make a really good argument for both.
Well, yeah, I think you could argue for both from our point of view, but I think from Nintendo's point of view, they're like, cha-ching, let's put this behind a paywall.
This
like,
seems, as we pretty all know, Nintendo is amazing at leveraging its classic games to be able to make money.
I was going to say, what a far-fetched rumor that Nintendo would re-release its classic games on the Switch.
Yeah.
What?
No, obviously, it will eventually happen. Like, there's just, it's not a question. Like, it will definitely happen. These are much, much easier to emulate than N64 games, which
we've
struggled with a little bit, right? And there's an incredible library. You know, not everybody wants to go back and play games from the kind of from the GBA and the 8-bit and 16-bit ages on their brand new gaming machine. But,
well, they're wrong.
They are awesome, awesome GBA games.
Yeah.
And yeah.
I was going to say, that's a really strong... Yeah. It's a really strong prediction pair. So that's definitely going to happen, because Nintendo in the past has had a little bit of a checkered history of actually getting GBA games onto their individual platforms. For years and years, everybody's like, GBA games on 3DS, when? And it seemed like it was going to happen because of the ambassador program, but they just never really got it working and then just kind of abandoned it. Of course, they eventually came out on the Wii U. But yeah, I don't know. Like,
the
is it
pressure? the pressure is there to deliver more value for their subscription, especially now that a higher paid tier exists. Because, you know, Game Pass is a different beast. Sony is stepping up their game, right? Streaming is expanding everywhere. Nintendo has to provide the value. And like, I have not seen them outside of Tetris 99 and releasing new themed updates. I haven't seen them actually create something specifically for their online service or debut something other than, you know, the higher tier now has the DLC packs obviously packed in. But like, of course they will go back to their, they will go to their back catalog. And as we've seen with the Super NES and the 8-bit games, they're kind of scraping the bottom of their barrel, and they're probably struggling getting third parties to want to commit and give them Sonic and Castlevania and Contra games, because those companies are releasing them as editions, right? As compilations.
I think Game Pass has kind of changed everything for all of video games for forever and all time, because it is so enormously successful, and also the backwards compatibility. I mean, I have all these Xbox 360. I still have some original Xbox games that I can play right now. I'm probably not going to, because I only bought them because they're at a thrift store. But, you know, some of them still hold up really well. And these old 8-bit, the 16-bit, the Game Boy. One of Pear's favorites, Tactical Ogres.
Still haven't got an Ogre Battle on that even.
No. And it's pretty trivial to emulate these, like you were saying, compared to the Nintendo 64, which there's really no great Nintendo 64 emulation anywhere. It's not just a problem with the Nintendo Switch. And I think because this model is so huge, and we are seeing Sony sort of dipping its toes in, like, I think it's a matter of time. Nintendo has got to know that we will give them more money for these things. They've just never had the competitive reason to do so until now. Yep. So I won't be as confident as parents say that they definitely will, because I know Nintendo can be very tricky.
But that's the Nintendo approach, right? Like, they're not going to spend a ton of money developing a new Fire Emblem and then releasing it into the subscription service, because they can keep on selling these games. Like, if you look at the top 10 sellers, you know, of the year, you'll find Switch games in there that have come out years ago. They're launch games in the top selling games, and to include that in a subscription would actually mean making less money, right? And so that's why I think it is going to be these kind of smaller multiplayer focused releases like Tetris 99 and then classic library stuff, and they have to step it up there.
What I found interesting, and I touched a little bit on this when I did that feature that compared the revamped PlayStation Plus with Game Pass and Switch, and I when I was writing it out, I was like, the big three are just taking a very radically different approaches on how they're kind of preserving legacy games, specifically legacy games that they might have in their vault. But I do agree with you all. I think that, you know, Nintendo does need to step up with their Switch Online offerings, because, you know, Sony and Xbox are already kind of putting out, you know, their best foot forward, or going to, because I know the new PlayStation Plus hasn't come out yet. So I think at some point Nintendo is going to have to step it up.
I think honestly, if they designed a service for me, they would go back to something that they tried and that failed because it relied on hardware that nobody bought, which was the broadcast satellite stuff. The Satellaview was such a cool idea that you would get gaming broadcasts. Now, obviously, you know, you have to be respectful of when people can play and people's time, and that's another issue. But they released like a 20-minute narrated Zelda adventure with an announcer and people playing all at the same time. Like, that sort of stuff was so exciting. And they played around with these cool concepts of taking classic games and remixing them and re-releasing them on this, you know, Satellaview BS service, BS broadcast satellite. Sorry, it wasn't a BS service. And like, I'm surprised they haven't gone down that route in a bigger way and tried to make that happen again. Maybe that's something that we'll see in the future.
I love you for bringing up Satellaview, Pear. Well done.
Nintendo doesn't get enough credit for like trying these really outrageous things ahead of when the technology can actually deliver them, right? Like the 64DD was this thing, like when they announced it was a great idea when it came out, it was way, way too late. But like being able to rewrite the game world and have a game where your footprints will stay forever, they announced it and they were way ahead of its time. And then they kind of bump, Bumble did away and the PC did it, right? And games like Elder Scrolls did it before they could. But yeah, it's there's so much to that sort of like going back to their classic back catalog and remixing it and maybe creating like these online events. Maybe everybody plays at the same time and whoever finishes gets the number one spot in the leaderboard, and it's like appointment gaming. Like all of that stuff could be really cool.
So basically like the Mario Battle Royale game that came out.
A little bit like that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's a very fun game.
I think that, so we've only really heard rumors that Game Boy games, like classic Game Boy games, are coming to Nintendo Switch. And there's a, you know, all the signs kind of point to that happening at some point this year. I haven't really heard anything about actual GBA games. It could just be them testing it. I agree that the time is going to be right for them to put GBA games on Switch, not just for all the reasons that you outlined, but because the Wii U and 3DS eShops are going to become unavailable at a certain point. And so that will functionally make a lot of these GBA games, which the GBA has grown into this beloved handheld. And it, there's an amazing library, a lot of wonderful games on there, not just ports. That would be really great on Nintendo Switch. God knows, having Metroid Zero Mission and Metroid Fusion on the Nintendo Switch to compare it to go right along with Metroid Dread would be absolutely wonderful. So let me tell you, I am 100% behind all of this. Having said that, they really need to revamp the apps because they can't have them all in separate apps. You can't have a Game Boy app and a GBA app and an NES app and a SNES app. You got to have an all-in-one solution, and they kind of have been working on that, but it's very clumsy at the moment. Yeah. They need a much better interface, in my opinion.
I thought the interface would evolve over time where it really makes you feel more like you own that machine, right? Like there's like this nostalgia to it. But instead, it's just like this quilt of game box art of different sizes, which, I know drives some people
something new to play.
Crazy, right? Like in the moment you add a Super Famicom box, it's like, how's it going to fit? No, it is really funny that they segmented it that way, but obviously that's probably due to each emulator being a separate app. And maybe they could someday create some sort of virtual console or something.
Oh, whoa.
They're folders now, right? You can put them all. You can put them all in a folder at least, right?
Yeah.
You can do
I don't
that,
like how but... it's your playtime for, it doesn't matter how many different games on one of those services you play. It just shows you played, you know, X amount of hours.
I hate that too.
Yeah. I don't know why. It just drives me absolutely crazy. I think a cool interface is the Sega Genesis collection. I can't remember who released it. The emulation on that, not great, but you're in like a 1989 bedroom with the wood paneled walls, and you have your collection and you turn the TV on and you can sort of move around and it feels like you're in the past. They should just steal that. Old cloth. Just use that. It was really great. But, you know, keep the M2 assisted emulation like it's currently on the Genesis. But do you think that this could be why they release in Xenoblade Chronicles September release Game Boy? There it is. It's huge.
Yep.
No, nobody thinks that because it's not a good idea.
By the way, Kat, did you ever install the Nintendo Online Japanese versions of the app?
Oh, no, I didn't.
You should.
They have exclusive games, right?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, you can do like Shin Megami Tensei and Famicom Wars and stuff like that.
Harvest Moon.
Yeah. There's different...
Some Fire Emblems are in there, right?
I think there was like... what they do? They did Custom Robo 2 or something. Like, anyway, there's a ton in there. There's, Puyo Puyo was in there.
Goemon?
No. Of course not. Come on.
And how would I do that pair? Do I just need to go in through my Japanese account to the Switch eShop?
So you need to register a Japanese account with your Switch first. And what you don't actually have to have that account be part of a family plan or be a subscription. You just have to download the app and then you have to log into your American account, which is part of the subscription, and you get in.
Okay.
Yeah. And there's one, there's a separate one for the Genesis / Mega Drive. There's one for the Super NES, Super Famicom, and for the N64.
That's awesome.
I'm gonna do that so I can play Harvest Moon.
It will be all in Japanese, though. That's the only one.
You know what? I am fine with that, because I was really bummed that they didn't put it on the US. So I was like, fine. But now you're telling me this, and this just opened up a whole new oyster for me. So thank you, Pear.
Yeah, good stuff.
I think they should add more consoles. I mean, they added the Genesis. Didn't expect that. But in Virtual Console, you used to be able to buy Commodore 64 games. You used to be able to buy PC Engine and TurboGrafx games. So
yeah, I think the amount of people who care for that is like you're getting smaller and smaller. And you know, I was a Commodore 64 fan, but like, are people going to subscribe to get Amiga games, or are they going to just download the widely available ROMs that are easily?
They just released the Amiga Mini. 500.
Nobody's just doing those games, right? Like, nobody's asking for takedowns on these kind of classic home consoles. I'm a huge Atari 8-bit fan, too. Like, I love the home computers. And
I like that.
I want to play Pitfall 2 again.
I love how the original Wii, we were getting some really esoteric platforms by the end.
Yeah.
Like, we did, in fact, get Commodore 64, if I recall correctly.
Yes.
Yeah.
It's
there for ZX Spectrum fans out there. Phil, who would
the old ZX Specky, as they would call it in Xenoblade Chronicles?
I think it'd be difficult for Nintendo to figure out whom to pay for it at this point. Like,
that is true.
Who owns the rights to Paradroid? Or, you know, it's like, hello, Lucasfilm Games. We would love Rescue and Fractalus and the Eidolon, please.
Well, I love the fact that City Connection is owned by City Connection Limited. So there's a shell corporation set up just to distribute City Connection. So that's awesome.
There you go.
Yeah, there it is. Somebody asked this in question block, but I'm going to move it up forward a little bit. What three Game Boy Advance games would you most like to see come to a hypothetical Switch Online service expansion? Now, I will start it off because I realize I just put you all on the spot. But I think for me personally, I would love Golden Sun. I think that one I love Golden Sun. It's on my Wii U, but I don't know where my power cord is or part of my Wii U. I'm blanking on the Castlevania game, but it's on the Castlevania collection, so it'll never come out.
Aria of Sorrow?
Yes, thank you. And then the Final Fantasy VI version on Game Boy Advance, I've never played, but I've been told is the superior version to the Super
NES. It's a better localization, but the sound isn't as good.
Oh.
Because of the GBA sound chip.
Okay.
Now,
I'll still take it because we don't have it
localization,
anyway.
And it's kind of a matter of taste because I actually really like the Woolsey FF6 localization, even though it has weird things like Phoenix Down spelled F-E-N-I-X. But... you can get the enhanced localization and then just patch it onto a ROM of the original SNES game if you really want. And then the Pixel Remaster's out now too.
Oh yeah, that is also
true. But not on Switch. Where are you, Square?
The heck?
I would probably go, you know, we mentioned the Metroid Zero Mission. I would want Fusion too, but before that, probably Advance Wars. The GBA Advance Wars was really good. And then Fire Emblem for the GBA, which was a remake, but was also fantastic. The GBA was a great platform for the early Fire Emblems. I would love to see those. Minish Cap, obviously, let's not forget about that one.
Okay.
There are a lot of good things.
Yeah. Well, sure, there's a lot, but you have to pick three. I'm sorry, you picked three. Okay. Cat.
Zero what Mission, Advance Wars, Fire Emblem. There you go.
Perfect.
Pear stealing my ideas. I was actually breaking up my analog pocket over the weekend and just plugging in a bunch of GBA games. I agree with Pear. I think that we should get an Advance Wars. I would like to throw up Pokemon Emerald because one of the cool things about the 3DS is that it had Gen 1 and Gen 2 of Pokemon, and they connected to Pokemon Home. And that made it kind of united all of the generations in a really meaningful way. That was awesome. I would love to have Pokemon Emerald, which is the best version of Gen 3 and one of the best versions of Pokemon, period, to be on this emulation service and then to be able to have connectivity to Pokemon Home. That would be absolutely amazing. And then, of course, we have to have Metroid Zero Mission. It's just, it's the law. I think that it's I think it's the second best Metroid game.
I'm surprised they're not remaking that one. Have Mercury Steam do that one.
Metroid Zero Mission is so good. It's one of the it really did amazing things, the speedrunning scene and everything. And of course it introduced Zero Suit Samus. So it's a classic.
Nice. Taylor?
Yeah. Yeah. Well, first off, amen to Pokemon Emerald, Kat. I could not agree more. But I'm not gonna steal your idea and say Pokemon Emerald, but I do want Zelda Minish Cap. It was one of the first Zelda games that I actually played on like a handheld. And so there's a little nostalgia with that. I also would love Pokemon Pinball, Ruby and Sapphire, because I played so much of that. I wish I could find my cartridge. And I would have said Metroid Fusion, but that was already taken. So I'm gonna throw a wild card out there and say Pokemon Mystery Dungeon Red Rescue Team. Because I did play the remake. I know we have the remake, so we'll probably never get it. But I was a little disappointed with the remake, so I'd rather play the original. I still have my cartridge. It's actually on my desk. So, but I don't have an analog pocket. It's going to take forever for me to get one. So I was like, just put it on. Give us GBA games and then put that on there on Switch Online. Come on, Nintendo. Please do it.
Yeah.
Analog Nintendo, pocket please. Is very good, Taylor. You should get one.
Yeah, if you can get an analog pocket.
You could get them for like 300 some bucks on eBay right now. I just checked recently. Yeah. And if you get the dock with it, which by the way, thank you, Seth. That was amazing.
No problem.
Being able to play, say, Metroid Zero Mission on your TV. Amazing.
Yeah. Oh, who needs Switch Online for that stuff? There you go.
All you need is
another $300.
Yeah, I was gonna say, you want to complain about prices of Switch Online expansion, then you get into trying to find these old games at anything but an affordable price. Although there are some decent games out there that are like $30, but if you want these classics, oh boy.
Yeah.
Pick up all your 3DS games now.
That's the hobbyist life.
Yeah. I mean, it's the hobbyist life, but it has gotten completely out of hand over the last 2 years. Oh, yeah. I'm sure I've talked about the new 2DS XL Hylian Shield Edition from GameStop. I sold 2 years ago for $300. I bought it for $179 and now it's like $600. And it might actually be more because I don't look at it very often because it just makes me so very sad.
I don't blame you.
Yeah, and sometimes when I feel like I want to get a little spendy, I look at my my other gold new 3DS XL. I still have that one's $300 or $400 and I don't know, I really like that one a lot though. I use the hell out of it. So yeah, collecting games sucks. Don't get into it. It's too expensive. It's too expensive and hard.
You also run out of room.
Yes, you run. Know. That is.
Kids are moving out. I'm thinking about downsizing to a smaller place in the future. And I'm like, I'm looking at this game collection. I don't know where to put it.
Wait, if the kids are moving, you're gonna down. Yeah.
Into a smaller house, they'll be. Where am I gonna?
You'll need a guest room for the kids when they come home to visit. It just also happens to be filled with boxes.
I also have a couple of books.
Books are for nerds. Who needs books? Yeah.
And then all the consoles.
My whole thing with collecting is that I get the games that mean the absolute most to me, and then I have them out and everything, and then I don't care about anything else, honestly. So
there you go.
I may only have like a dozen classic games, but they are some of my absolute favorite games, and I love having them for one reason or another.
Yeah, and I think that's probably the absolute like best and healthiest way to be a game collector. Whereas you have some idiots like me who will see a DS game for $2 10 years ago and buy it, knowing that he'll be able to sell it for like $50. You know, it's not a good investment. It takes a long time to mature, and they're not very liquid. You can't just turn them around, but
yeah, if you don't store them the right way, they just don't taste as good in the end too.
Having said that, there's been a copy of Os Tatakae Oendon over at our local retro game shop for like a month, and I just keep going, why haven't I bought this yet? It's right here. I'm gonna buy it. Oendon is the rhythm game became Elite Beat Agents in America.
I think you should be buying that.
Yeah, no, you should do that. I remember the go ahead, Per.
I think I have that. I think I have that somewhere.
They're so good if you've never played them.
Awesome. Yeah.
Yeah, the game that I think one of the rarest games that I probably own in my collection, I'm just like looking at my shelf, even though I already know what I'm going to say on the spot. I remember, about 5 years ago, I saw a sealed copy of Chrono Trigger on the Nintendo DS.
Whoa.
And ask me how much I paid. Ask me how much I paid for it.
I bet you paid $45 for it.
I paid
$35. Oh my God.
Yeah.
That is
that's nice.
One of my prized possessions.
That's an incredible get, Taylor. Well done.
Yeah, I was like, I'm so proud of myself. I was like, it is now my most prized DS game that I own. I was like, I love this. Never letting it go. Never selling the 3DS. Nope. I was like, nope. This is mine for the rest of my life. You know me, Kat. I'm really good at finding a good deal. It's like one of my superpowers. Seth loves it. Yes, yeah, Seth knows. Seth, we did Black Friday. We covered Black Friday together. You know. Yep. You know what's up.
Yeah. Kat, how much was WoW done? I only have the US release.
Oh, sorry. How much was
how much is it? WoW done.
Endon? Oh, that's it was really cheap. It's like $30.
Oh, yeah, there you go.
Yeah.
It's not bad.
Okay.
Now you got me all thinking about just not looking at any booths at PAX tomorrow and just going straight to the used game. Spending stupid amounts of money. But anyway, now it's time for a Kat take. Kat, I believe you have a take for us this week.
I do have a take. And it's a little bit more of a serious take because this week, an unnamed employee filed a complaint with the National Labor Relations Board about Nintendo, alleging that Nintendo had prevented them from organizing. And this is interesting to me. It's a story that's been kind of picking up steam a little bit. And the reason it's interesting to me is, you know, we're all Nintendo fans and everything. And I think there's a lot of kind of, wow, it would be so amazing to go work at Nintendo, be working at the Willy Wonka's chocolate factory and everything. But I think it's a reminder to me that Nintendo is still a corporation, it's a business, and it's subject to everything else that we've been seeing. And there's been, over the past year, if you've been kind of following it, you know, we've seen everything that's been happening with Activision Blizzard, Raven Software. There's been a big push on the unions and workplace abuses and that everything. So the fact that the spotlight is kind of turning toward Nintendo on this is really notable to me. Nintendo actually sent a statement to IGN and a few other places saying that this employee was let go for divulging sensitive information and for no other reason, and that they were not aware of them like trying to stop them from organizing or anything and would be cooperating with the investigation. But now if you look on Twitter, you have contractors in particular starting to come out and say, hey, like things weren't kosher over at Nintendo. This is a story that's still kind of developing, but I think it bears watching because it is a serious topic in the games industry lately, and it shows that Nintendo is definitely not immune, as beloved as it is.
Wow. No one is immune.
No.
Serious Kat take this week.
Yeah.
Thank you for that. Any comments to go along with the Kat take?
I mean, would love to know a little bit more about that story, right? Yeah. Like the relationship between corporations and unions is tricky in that sometimes all it takes one exec who doesn't know how to interface with, you know, unionization and the processes and says the wrong thing, and it can blow up and it can really be damaging to a company, right? If there's any sense of obstruction, the processes are complicated, right? Where the majority of the employees have to be in favor of pursuit, but like exec or the corporate side cannot stand in the way of that sort of organization and that expression and pursuit. And so that, you know, it's risky. I'm sure they're taking it seriously. And, you know, the only thing they can do is to be completely open to an investigation there.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, speaking personally for me, I've heard many stories over the years about what it's like to actually work with Nintendo. And I think I've said before, it's a very traditional and very conservative company, especially on the Japanese side. And I think that people have been pretty tight-lipped over the years about kind of the ins and outs, but I've known plenty of people who are like, no, I got burned out. I decided to leave Nintendo. And you kind of go, okay, but what's going on there? I kind of want to know. So it's going to be a story that bears watching over the next year or so.
Yeah, absolutely. Interested to follow along with it. I have a pair of friends who are actually union contract negotiators, and we'll be on Discord, and they'll be talking about going to Auto Factory. And it sounds like, I mean, they're both pretty happy guys, but it also sounds like their job is the worst in the world because they are just constantly just beat down and upset about something. So anyway, thank you, Kat, for that thoughtful Kat take this week. And of course, we'll be returning to this story as it develops. Now we need to get into some more video game talk because there was a big old pile of video games to talk about this week. On top of Xenoblade Chronicles 3, we've got the Shadowrun Trilogy, which is coming to Switch. I've never played the Shadowrun game, so I'm looking forward to this. Force Unleashed is out, I think, today, which originally came out on the Xbox 360 PS3. So, you know, it's probably going to lag a little bit on the
Switch.
Not
that one. Not that one. We're getting the Wii version.
Oh, the definitive version. Oh.
It is. It's not the same game at all. It's actually a different developer, you know, obviously shares themes and concepts and everything, but it was designed for motion controls, you know, the lightsaber combat. A lot of people think the Wii version is actually the better game when it comes to the just a pure gameplay of it. But obviously, presentation-wise, it's going to be interesting to see what this looks like on the Switch.
It's interesting that they picked that one and not the classic Xbox 360 PS3 ones.
Nintendo
as flawed as they were, if like the lightsaber in that game felt like a baseball bat, but
yeah,
it was a big deal when it came out because of the Havoc engine, the Havoc physics. You can mess around with light stormtroopers and whatnot with force powers. And the other thing that's interesting is technically at the time Force Unleashed was canon.
Yeah,
it is no longer canon. It is in the Legends category.
Legends. That's right.
It is an area that Lucas is actually exploring a lot in Star Wars Obi-Wan Kenobi, which is set in roughly the same time period. So my question is, are we going to bring back Starkiller? Starkiller going to be rescued and put in the live action series?
Oh, we're seeing clips of it now, and it looks like a Wii game, very much. So it is.
It looks pretty good for a Wii game.
Sure. I'll give it that. But
it's dope that they're using the Joy-Cons to.
The entire game was designed around it. That's why the Wii version is so different, right? Like it definitely was. It was supposed to be the lightsaber combat showcase.
That we had dreamed about since.
That we had dreamed about and never quite got in the end.
I sure don't miss gimmicky motion controls. I'll just say that much.
But it's optional for the Switch version. So, you know, there you go. It definitely, you know, it's, again, the presentation, you will remember how blurry Wii games were.
That 480i resolution of the
Did Aspyr work on this one? Are they publishing it?
No, who was the hold on, I'm gonna look it up before we say something.
I mentioned Aspyr because they've been very busy lately and they've been growing a lot. Their ports have been getting progressively better. I was actually pretty impressed by their work on KOTOR.
They were, I mean, they used to be the studio for the Mac ports, and then you know, branching out. It was Redfly Studio did the Wii version. They worked on a bunch of stuff like Ghostbusters the video game and TMNT.
I've always meant to get around to playing Ghostbusters. I've never got around to that one.
I'm the same. I never got around to it.
The real sequel, the one we deserved over Afterlife.
It's pretty good. You mentioned TNMT. We got a release window for Shredder's Revenge, which is coming out summer of 2022. And it's at PAX East, and I'm going to try to play it, get my hands on it. That is, of course,
amazing
the new
time
game
for TMNT beat 'em ups between the Digital Eclipse.
Oh,
yes.
That looks amazing.
Right. And we got the announced, well, I should say they went live yesterday. The $150 collector's edition of the Cowabunga collection came and went in a blur. It was in stock at Target, sold out. In stock at Best Buy, sold out. In stock at Amazon, sold out. But as far as I know, it came back at Best Buy, and it might still be there. So if you really want this, and it's a really good special edition. I know some people were complaining about the price, but if I personally was looking at what you get, and I was like, yeah, I'm ordering this, and never opening it, because that's just the horrible person that I am. But probably the biggest game announcement outside of Xenoblade Chronicles, Sonic Origins, which is the remasters of Sonic's 1, 2, and 3, and Sonic CD. And of course, it's probably now infamous chart of baffling features that some have and some don't. Nobody really knows, but you get the chart with two rings on it, and then for $44 you get the chart with all the rings on it. You get medallions, you get 100 medallions if you, I don't know what that means, but it's pretty exciting. Is anyone able to unravel this arcane mystery that is the Sonic Origins collection?
I guess there are 8 pieces of DLC coming out for Sonic Origins.
Perfect amount.
Including stuff like hard mode missions and a mirror mode and certain pieces of music and the like. And this is all locked behind a paywall, and people hate paying for things.
Yes.
And I'm not saying that they're wrong about this. It's kind of remarkable that they're locking these features behind all of behind extra money. But yeah, those Sonic fans aren't particularly happy, which is too bad, because Sonic Origins collection as a whole looks great.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah,
it looks like the anniversary mode actually has full widescreen, which that's awesome if that's the case.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah.
I'll probably buy it regardless, but
the collection looks great. The DLC stuff is completely annoying anti-consumer BS. Like, yeah, it's awful. Like, it's, you know, we're going back to those times where, like, in order to get this extra thing, you got to buy it at Walmart, but if you buy it there, you can't get the thing you get at Target. And it's like, I thought we left those days behind us. Like, it's literally nickel and diming for features that are done, produced, that add value to the collection beyond buying the classic games. And it's not like where you're buying a game for full price and then a couple of months later, a DLC add-on pack comes out that the developer worked on for months after. And it's bull. It's really, really annoying. I think I can't say anything positive or nice about it. It's anti-consumer. It's nickel and diming. It's awful. I will buy the base collection. Thank you very much.
Yeah,
I right here.
Yeah, I still think about how much fun I had with all the bonus stuff that was included in like the Sonic Mega Collection and Sonic Gems Collection. I still have both of those on the GameCube. So when I saw that, I mean, am I still gonna buy this? I don't know, maybe. I was like, or I could just fire up my GameCube and play those instead.
I own all these games already, right? So for me, adding something special to it really seals the deal on me wanting to own it in a format that is easier for me to play and replay. So don't do this bull. If you have to make a freaking map towards what you get when you do what, like,
it's a little Orphan Annie decoder ring that you need.
Yeah, seriously. Like, you gotta put on the 3D glasses. Yeah. And, yeah.
I think for me personally, the most baffling thing is it's only like $5 more, but it seems like so pointless because to why not just make the game come out for $44 with all the stuff and don't even bother with a $39.99 edition. Like, I don't think anybody is like, well, I would have bought it for $39.99, but for $45, that's just too much money.
The trick is giving you, like, it's the fear that you're setting the price point at a point where the audience on, you know, certainly people on social media will get upset saying this is too much money. And so they have the low price point and then they're selling the people really want it, the high price
point.
But
it's not even that different of a price point.
I think that was the intention, but it's just, it's misguided and stupid.
I'll tell you, the absolute best model that nobody gives enough credit to is Microsoft Flight Simulator. Now, granted, there were three different editions that you could buy at the start, and the expensive one was like $109. But the amount of content that they continuously give you, and that game came out in 2020. It is 2022 now. There's tons more planes. There's tons more locations. There's new missions. They've added so much to it, and they don't charge you for it at all. You could fly an F/A-18 just like Maverick in the upcoming movie.
Wait,
is Maverick flying an F-18 or an F-14?
In the new one, he's flying an F-18. They've retired the Tomcat.
Oh my god.
Yeah, I know.
Oh my god.
But that's what happens when you have a naval career spanning like 47 years.
Yeah.
I didn't know you were that old.
What?
Yeah, you.
Yeah, how old do you think I am?
A naval career of 47 years.
Yeah, I'm a 69 year old man. I just look great because I didn't get out in the sun at all. I never went on the deck. I was always below decks. that's the trick of it. Sonic Origins comes out on June 23rd, and they did clean up the chart a little bit. Oh, it may be
Switch. The Switch version is the only one without pre-orders right now. It's on all platforms, including PC, and like the Switch version doesn't have a listing on Nintendo's shop yet or a pre-order link. So hopefully, it's not one of those. Oops, sorry, it's now October or something.
Yeah, this is absolutely a Switch game for me. It's sort of like the Cowabunga collection, and I know just from our own data on IGN deals, like the Switch version is probably 4 times more popular than the next. Which is PlayStation. Like people just, these games just belong on Switch.
It's actually somewhat hard to find Sonic 3 and Sonic and Knuckles.
It is.
Yeah, we were talking about that a couple of episodes ago, and there it is. Yeah.
There you go. So that's why that would be a good reason for me to buy it, honestly. Yeah, you're right, Pear. And the thing, and I guess the final note is normally Sega is very good about how they handle a lot of their stuff. They put out these really high quality 3D remakes or collections and that kind of thing. So it surprises me to see them mishandling it with Sonic.
It's almost like it's inflation pricing. Maybe they have to pay some more money down in the supply chain somewhere, and they're like, how are we going to recoup it? But Sega, be Arizona iced tea, man.
Come on. Oh, I love me some Arizona.
Be the Costco hot dogs, which are still $1.50 with a hot dog that's, you know, not like an average size hot dog. It's pretty like about a foot long, it feels. And then you get a soda too on top of that.
If you bought a cow and you chopped it into hot dogs, it would still cost more than their hot dog. Like, I don't know how it's possible. Anyway.
I have a feeling there's not a lot of cow in there.
Cows into hot dogs, please, people. No. Don't do that.
All right, let's talk about what we have been playing. And I'm very excited because, and this is a whole story that I have to tell, but I went thrift shopping this weekend and I've been striking out month after month. I don't find any electronics. I don't find any clothes. I just haven't found anything good. And then this week I was going through the cassette tapes and I was finding a lot of very good cassette tapes, including like a Bobby Brown album that I didn't even know existed called like Get On Stage or something. And it's like very early Bobby Brown, 1986. Anyway, I've got this stack of audio cassettes that are awesome. Def Leppard and AC/DC and of course Prince, or excuse me, not, I wish Prince, two Bobby Browns. I turn around and there's the 13-inch VCR TV combo that I have been searching for forever, because it turns out most thrift stores will not accept those as donations anymore because people just don't want to buy a CRT, with the exception of weirdo retro gamers like me. So I got a 13-inch JVC TV VCR combo. I plugged my Super Nintendo into it. It looks just how I wanted it to be. Oh, I also bought a stack of VHS, which also, by the way, Goodwill will no longer be accepting donations for VHS unless they're Disney. So if you see VHS and they're good, buy them. Like I did, I bought all the good ones. I have all the Lethal Weapons. I have Speed. I have Lost World on VHS now. Anyway, I've been playing Tales of Phantasia, which I won in a contest on a Facebook group like 5 years ago. And it's a repro cart that somebody made with a fan, a very good fan translation. I've never played Tales of Phantasia anymore, but I am really, really loving it. And the fact that it's on this tiny little TV with all its CRT goodness makes it that much better. And by the way, at 13 inches, VHS and old video games look really good. So that's it for me. Tales of Phantasia.
Tales of Phantasia is a little underrated, so I look forward to your thoughts.
I didn't expect the battle system to be like it was. I thought it was just going to be a traditional, you know, turn-based sort of battle system like in Final Fantasy, and it's not at all. And it's got it's exactly the kind of 16-bit JRPG graphics that I just, and the Mode 7 overworld, come on now.
Looks great.
Who can resist?
Yeah. Looking game.
Yeah.
Kat, we were talking about you in the office the other day. We want to create a CRT classic gaming corner in the office because we have so much room. Like we gotta find a decent CRT. And we gave Fran his back. He stored it in the office for like 300 years and we finally gave it to him.
Shouldn't have done
we
that.
Need a new one.
No offense to Fran.
You know what? It was a great Sony Trinitron, one of the last CRTs that were great, but it was a 16x9 one, which was good for like the GameCube era of 480p games, but not great for Super NES and you know.
Before What's funny that. Is I saw a CRT sitting on the curb just the other day, and I was just like, "Oh, CRT. Well, I've already got one. That's fine." But So now I kind of regret not grabbing it and bringing it into the office. But
that's
what
I'm telling you. That's right.
Sam Claiborne, who was, I think, on last week's episode.
Yep.
He is known for having like a billion CR televisions. So he's the one right there.
Yeah, we're talking about it. And he brought it up, Kat.
Awesome.
Yep.
I'm excited. Play some Star Fox 64 in the office. Here we go.
Exactly.
Well, what have you been playing otherwise?
Who's you?
I was asking Kat. I mean, you haven't been playing Star Fox 64 yet.
Can I talk about a movie?
Of course.
Have y'all seen Everything Everywhere All at Once?
I have not.
Not yet, no.
Oh my God.
It looks awesome. Looks great.
It's so good. It is one of the best movies I've ever watched. I haven't felt this way since I watched The Matrix. It is such a unique movie. So clever. Amazing action sequences. So absurd. Yep. One of the craziest movies I've ever watched, but it has heart. I wasn't expecting it to hit as hard as it ended up hitting. It is definitely a must-see, not-to-miss action movie. It's great.
And the kid from Goonies and Indiana Jones is in it, right?
Yeah, yeah. And he's great. Yeah, he steals the show. Yeah.
No longer a kid.
No, he's quite wonderful. There was an article about just how meaningful that character is. Just
that's awesome.
Yeah. So if you haven't seen Everything Everywhere All at Once, it's in theaters right now. Go watch it ASAP. Cool. It's great. See it in the theater for sure. It's a movie you want to see in the theaters.
No promises, but I'll see what I can do. We still haven't seen Sonic 2, and that's what the kids want to go see. So.
Oh, yeah. You got to go see it. It's
I know.
So
we're
going to
see it. We're going to go see it. We just haven't yet. Taylor, what have you been playing?
What have I been playing?
Yeah.
Well, I was playing the House of the Dead remake recently.
Oh,
and
just color me surprised.
Taylor's favorite game.
Well, I don't know if I liked it that much. I mean, you saw what I gave it. I mean, it's fun. I liked it. I forgot how many hours I clocked in before I like finished the review. I think it was almost 30 or about 30. And then I found out today, I was like, oh my God, it's coming out on PC and PlayStation and all these other platforms. I was like, cool. I was like, best believe I'm gonna play this on PC now. But I was playing that. I've been meaning to try to get into Lego Star Wars The Skywalker Saga. Oh. I have it on PC now, and I want to try it on PC. I actually installed it on my Steam Deck, even though it's not verified. But I'm gonna.
Oh, it'll be fine.
Find out. Yeah, I think it'll be fine.
Yeah.
House of the Dead remake. Yeah, because I've been playing it specifically with my family. I've talked a little bit about it on Twitter, but that was like one of the first like games that I remember playing like as a kid. I remember playing the Dreamcast, playing House of the Dead 2, and like me and my family on the weekends, we would just take turns trying to see how far we could get and actually beat the game. And then I've played all the other House of the Dead games. I it was one of the first games I got for the original Xbox.
Wow, Typing
the
of the
crap
Dead.
Out of that. Typing of the Dead is really good. I love Typing of the Dead. I really wish they'd been. Well, okay, so like I know the most accessible one is the Overkill on Steam, but it doesn't capture that same type of charm that the original one had. And it's like the original is just a walking meme, and I love it.
Suffer like G did? ? Is that an invitation? I don't know.
That's awesome.
Classic. We were actually talking about a top 10 Dreamcast games recently for a list, and Typing of the Dead came up, and it is one of my all-time favorite games. It's not one of my all-time favorite games, but I really enjoyed playing that game on the Dreamcast back in the day.
I never played it. I've only ever heard about it. But I have a Dreamcast, and now I have a CRT, so...
There you go.
Yeah.
So get on it. You gotta get on it. It is a masterpiece.
I just have to get the typing, or the keyboard.
The little Dreamcast keyboard controller.
Which I'm sure is very inexpensive.
Doing the little punctuations as the leeches are jumping out of the swamp at you.
What I like about it too is that I like how they still capitalize everything for sure. It's just like proper grammar and stuff. But I was like, no, you can still just like type the lowercase letter for it and they will penalize you. I was like, no, but if you miss a comma, they will call you out on it. You'll get whacked. You'll lose a hit point. So, which I'm glad. I was like, yes, it actually, Kat, I think we were talking about this too, like during that meeting. It helped me get better at my typing.
I hope if somebody types less instead of fewer, it resets the game and deletes your save.
It's Typing of the Dead, not Grammar of the Dead.
Okay, all right. I want Grammar of the Dead.
Okay. Oh, other than Grammar of the Dead, what have you been playing?
Well, good news, everyone. I finished Tunic, and
excellent.
Is definitely my game of the year.
No kidding.
So, again, we're still still waiting. Man, layers upon layers of awesome secrets. Waiting for the Switch version still, of course. And I think I'm tiring of Pikmin Bloom. I haven't talked much about it, but I kept on playing Pikmin Bloom whenever I walk around or travel somewhere and, like, you know, exchanging postcards with friends and stuff. But I think I'm getting bored because I don't know. I don't get out enough. So I've gone back to playing Kirby, which I'm playing in co-op with my son, and I love it. And I started playing Gotta Protector's Cart of Darkness.
Now, please explain this.
Yeah, so Acer brought this to the West. It's actually from, if you guys know your video game composers, Yuzu Koshiro created a company, a co-founded company called Ancient. Yuzu Koshiro is the composer, of course, of ActRaiser. Brought him up before as that being one of the most amazing soundtracks. Streets of Rage, he did Castlevania, Portrait of Ruin, he worked on Smash, all sorts of stuff. And so Gotta Protectors is the weirdest freaking franchise. It, I think it came to the West first for the Xbox, on Xbox Live as, what was it called, Protect Me Night? Protect Me Night, and then it there was a 3DS one, and this is the third game in the series. It's called Gotta Protectors, and it's Gotta Protect Her. You know, it's the knight's protecting the princess. Who? Okay, the story is great. It's like she's inside a castle on rails. It's you know, princess's moving castle basically, and it goes around on rails. And so it's basically an action tower defense game where four players can play co-op and wail on enemies to clear the path, defend the princess, and the princess then with her castle attacks the final fortress in each level. So it's like this really kind of clever little puzzle game. It's got an 8-bit look. It's super cheesy, super heavily punny stuff. You collect cartridges, which are all puns themselves based on classic gaming franchises. So it's kind of like, it's for NES lovers. It's chaotic. It's definitely a good time with four players. It's freaking weird as hell. Yeah, and you know, 8-4 obviously works on localizing Japanese games, and did definitely worked hard on making this funny and odd and quirky in the US. It's it's a very, very strange game, and like it came and went. I think it's a bit under the radar, but like if you've got a couple of people for couch co-op, go for this one.
Is there a physical release of this, or is it download only?
There's a limited edition one that's coming out. But I don't think it's out yet.
Okay. Yeah,
it's an eShop game.
I'm watching the footage of it. I'm like, this is the kind of game I would like to own. Physically.
Yeah, it's super. It's a little bit like, it's almost like a clicker game. You just have to hit enemies that much. Like it's just constantly converging masses of enemies, and then you gotta hit like the little barriers that hold back the enemies. It's very, very NES referential and everything. It's cute.
All right, that is Gotta Protectors, and it's on the eShop right now. And this is one of those games that if I had my Switch right here, I would just
download this. It's definitely Seth Macy weird.
And yeah, and you saying that it's a clicker game or sort of like that. I mean, my youngest son was deeply into Cookie Clicker recently. So
it's more strategic than that. I don't want to undersell it. But you do hit that button.
Well, he was only into it for the memes. He wasn't doing it because he was trying to increase the amount of clicking he could do. He just wanted to start the grim apocalypse or something.
Yeah, that's
not exactly sure. I just remembered real quickly before we end the show, I also found all the hookups for my N64, and I was playing some Pilot Wings 64 because I just love Pilot Wings. I wish they would bring Pilot Wings back. I don't know why. I guess they don't really
need to. Me too, I'm a big fan.
Yeah, I love, and like I've said before, I'm the world's greatest Pilot Wings player on the Super Nintendo. It's nobody is as good as
world's greatest.
People don't like peaceful flying games, right? Like Flight Simulator obviously got a boost by being a part of Game Pass, but like one of my favorite games of all time, Sky Odyssey on the PlayStation, nobody bought it, nobody played it. It's spectacular. And Pilot Wings had to be baked into Wii Sports Resort in order for anybody to pay attention to it, right? Like I do love those flight challenge games.
Yeah,
man.
There was a time, you know, when this game came out, which was a launch Super NES game, and I got it for Christmas. I played it so much that I could get perfect scores on every single test, and you know where they would be weeping, eyes open. The instructors would be weeping. I can't do that anymore, but I'm still very, very good at it, and it surprised me.
How... Well, your 40-year naval aviation career, I'm sure, really helped.
Well, yeah, and I was actually able to land on the carrier deck in the Top Gun for NES.
Wow. Oh
no, that's a lie. Nobody ever did that. That's that's where the game ends. There's no code after that. Oh, look at that. So good. I played this game so much, when I would go to sleep, I would dream about the rocket pack mission.
Sound effects are so good too.
Yeah, it's such a great game. Great soundtrack. It sounds like the Wii music. Actually,
but people are just like, you know, Pilot Wings 64 was at an age when polygons were starting to become, you know, games,
right?
3D worlds became more sophisticated, so there was this attraction to seeing this world rendered in 3D and just being like able to soar around. And like nowadays people want more, right?
We don't need Pilot Wings anymore, because as much as I love them, every Pilot Wings was just a tech demo for the system.
Boat 7 like or polygons,
or the when the 3DS came out, you know, it showed off the 3D of that system, and so we don't need it anymore. That's okay. We still have several of them, and I love them all. So anyway,
I still need them.
That is all the time we have for Nintendo Voice Chat today. Please come to Boston tomorrow if you can at 1:30. If you are listening to this the day after Friday, you missed out. It was a good time. Thanks to everyone involved. But make sure to follow us on Twitter at NVC Podcast. Submit your question block questions on the NVC Facebook group. By the way, someone said they couldn't find it. It is an unofficial group. So you do have to request to be made a member of the group, and then you'll see us all in there chit-chatting about Xenoblade and whatnot. Taylor, thank you so much for coming out and joining us today. And I want to thank Red on the ones and twos, and most of all, thanks to you for listening along with us. And remember, NVC is the only place where you can
get the thing.
Get the thing.
Get the thing.